Vibcoding and AI agents are at the forefront of the next AI arms race. Sure, you've probably heard of models like Claude-3.7 being great for coding in conjunction with AI tools like Cursor and WindSurf, but today all of that has changed. WindSurf has actually released a series of three models that are specifically for coding and that nearly match the performance of the current state of the art. This is really cool because it completely changes the notion that you need thousands of people, billions of dollars, and tens of thousands of immensely expensive NVIDIA GPUs to create foundation models that, on top of being relatively capable, can also understand how to code. They're also questioning what it means to have LLMs write software, not just understanding what the code itself does, but understanding what actually running it means, which has been a massive oversight in a lot of these tools. A lot of this has to do with the fact that they were just acquired by OpenAI, and it's made more interesting by the fact that OpenAI actually themselves released more coding-focused models today. So I want to get into all of this in this video, basically my thoughts as a professional software engineer, and what that means if you're someone who wants to get into vibe coding in any capacity. Welcome to AI Flux, let's get into it. So this release is really interesting, not only because of the recent acquisition of WindSurf by OpenAI, but because there's been a push by a lot of these companies to seemingly create better ways to capture better training data to create better coding experiences. The best example of this was Anthropic's Claude Code, which really was just a command line interface to Claude with some very specific bindings and tools that would let you write code faster. We've also seen this with the Cursor integration they have that's called a Claude Max, which is just a much faster interface and iteration loop when you use Anthropic to code. And this has become an essential attribute of a lot of these coding tools. WindSurf and Cursor work in very different ways, and they present data to the underlying models in relatively different ways, which requires understanding the context of what a programmer is doing. What's interesting with the acquisition of WindSurf by OpenAI is it starts to close the loop with a lot of these things. It's narrowing the focus down to just programming, and it's also giving a much cleaner data input to WindSurf to actually use this to improve their tools. And what I believe happened was WindSurf said, look, we have a reasonable way of anonymizing this data. Why don't we use this to create specific models that only do programming? In my experience, the quote-unquote thinking features of a lot of these models actually makes the coding experience worse. And with WindSurf, my interpretation has been that they want to be the Apple of these tools, which basically means providing the most powerful and consistent user interface to Vibcode that currently exists. And what's really cool is today we actually have some insight into what these models are, why they were built, and some rough benchmarking. Of course, the benchmarks themselves are high level for now, but as soon as these are released, I can't wait to compare this to Claude 3.7, because right now I predominantly use Claude and nothing else. So this is the post on X where WindSurf made this announcement. Let's get into what they're actually building here. This is a set of three models, and the way they thought about these models was pretty interesting. The three models are SWE-1 Lite, which they describe as a lightweight model for everyday developers, SWE-1, which is the full strength model for complex tasks. How they define tasks, we'll get into in just a bit. And there's SWE-1 Mini, which they define as an ultra-fast model for low-latency tasks. And by low-latency tasks, I believe they mean things like line completion or tab completion, and features that are basically identical to GitHub Copilot, so basically just an autocomplete that's a bit more intelligent. And they give us a bit more information here. So they say, today we are launching our first family of models dubbed SWE-1, optimized for the entire software engineering process, not just the task of coding. And this is a recurring theme throughout this entire announcement. So the idea is, you know, LLM should understand how to write code, but they should also understand how to deploy it and use it. And WindSurf has already showed this with their deployment features and largely their notion of providing the kind of chat interface while you're vibe coding as more of a flow rather than just a back and forth changing different files. So they say here that SWE-1 can approximately match the performance of Claude 3.5 Sonnet in terms of tool calling and understanding code. This will be available for paid users, initially for free. So obviously there are benefits to developing these models and then probably having a lot of infrastructure from OpenAI to deploy inference on. They describe SWE-1 Lite as a smaller model that replaces Cascade Base at better quality. It's available for unlimited use to all users, free or paid. And this is something I should really mention, which is Cascade has always been basically free in WindSurf, but clearly wasn't as good as even models like DeepSeek V3. SWE-1 Mini is a small, extremely fast model that powers WindSurf tab passive experience for all users. So I'm glad I wasn't too far off with my expectations of what SWE-1 Mini would be for. And again, they say that their whole idea here is to accelerate software development as much as possible by not just having coding capable models, but models that understand what it is. And this is pretty much what they reiterate again in these three paragraphs. They basically say that we felt like there was a plateau of model performance in terms of really doing more things, and that in terms of building tooling into the tool itself, it felt more appropriate to actually have a few specific models that you could deploy that were just better at coding. And this is something that I find interesting because for me, the benefit of this trend, and it's not a necessarily new trend, this is something we saw 6 to 8 months ago when agents started to become really novel and small models started to have an interesting level of performance. So the trade-off was, instead of having a mixture of experts model that's pretty big and having different types of models that were good at different things, maybe just have one model that's really good at coding and then deploy those agentically as needed. What this means is that you can specialize a bit more without necessarily trading too much performance. And it also means that you can fit a lot of these more complex or more capable models onto way less hardware, which is cool. And unfortunately, most of these models I don't think will ever be open source because this is basically backed by OpenAI, but I don't think that's a bad thing. And I think if this gives rise to another generation of really small versions of DeepSeek or really small versions of, let's say, a coding model from Mistral, I think that would be really cool. I don't think it would take away from how great of a tool WindSurf is. So they say overall that SWE-1 is close to all of the frontier foundation models in terms of coding. They say importantly, it outperforms non-frontier models as well and open weight alternatives. And some of the reason this will always be the case with models that are deployed on like OpenAI infrastructure or Anthropic infrastructure is they can employ a lot of really fancy tricks like beam search. There are a bunch of these, a lot of these we will probably never see because they're trademarked and trade secrets. But these allow you to do things that you just cannot do locally, and that even if I tried to implement these for months, probably never reach the level of performance that you can get with closed source models and closed sourced infra. To the extent that in certain cases, you can actually be executing up to 7 inference runs in parallel. Anthropic has talked a little bit about this, and the more they hint about this, the more clear that there's certain advantages to closed source models in terms of inference that we'll never get even if you had $200,000 of GPUs in your basement. So let's get into some of the benchmarks. What they're using here is a conversational SWE task benchmark that was in part developed by WindSurf. So what they're starting with is a kind of half-baked task. So they're giving a task that's already been started with rough context and saying, let's see what we get here. And the performance is pretty interesting. The outputs are kind of a blend of judge scores from a number of different tasks. Hopefully we'll start to see some more of those in the future. And you'll see here that SWE-1 performs better than DeepSeek V3 and roughly matches the performance of all of the Claude models. Claude 3.5 is great. Anyone who's done any amount of vibe coding will tell you that Claude 3.5 and 3.7 perform and feel very different in terms of how they interact and how they write code. What is most impressive to me here is that SWE-1 Lite is massively outperforming Claude Haiku 3.5, Qwen 3, and Qwen 2.5 72B instruct. Qwen 3 was never a really strong local coding model anyway, but these are pretty interesting to see. What I find really interesting is this end-to-end SWE task benchmark, which they roughly say is intended to write tests to understand how the code is actually executing, which is the end-to-end piece of this, and is intended to start to take certain repetitive testing and troubleshooting tasks away from people. So the idea being that you could have a number of these agents running in the background or running concurrently. And again, SWE-1 Lite performs really well compared to mid-sized models. And in this case, SWE-1 actually shows a bit of an edge against Claude Sonnet 3.5. And what is cool about this is, you know, of course, you know, some people might say, oh, it's not better, it's just almost as good. But what's impressive here is this is probably a team of maybe 20 people that within less than a year, probably less than 6 months, created a model with very clean data that is matching the performance of something Anthropic made, which is a massive organization. And that is impressive. And it's just the first version. So whatever SWE 1.1 looks like will probably be very, very impressive, and I can't wait to see it. They also mentioned there were a number of production experiments. They roughly compared daily lines contributed per user written with Cascade and other models. One big reason to offer a lot of this basically for free is WindSurf understands how this model works, and they know how they trained it, which means that they also know how the data needs to be packaged to improve this even more. So as opposed to a user of WindSurf using Claude 3.5 Sonnet, where WindSurf would maybe be only getting half of the data coming in this case, they're getting much closer to 100%. And I don't really think that's an issue. WindSurf, if you look into this, Cursor as well, both have really great ways of obfuscating code, and that's only going to get better with time. And frankly, if we get more performance out of it, I don't really mind. And some of you might disagree with me because it's why you use local models, but I think in terms of programming and coding, this is a really interesting edge that I think will only lead to very good things on the open source side. The way WindSurf works lends itself well to what they call a flow-aware system, which basically means that it's pretty easy to understand different steps of development and different steps of doing things with software. It's why they're deliberate tools for deployment. It's why they're deliberate tools for just editing or asking about a certain problem. It's also why WindSurf a lot of times will perform better when you ask it really high-level questions. In other cases, might lead to a lot of unnecessary changes in other coding tools. I've specifically had this problem with Klein, and this is why I think if you're paying for credits or paying for tools, you should only use the leading edge because it's not really that expensive. And frankly, your inputs will probably lead to better returns down the line once this data is actually used to improve models, especially now that SWE-1 is a real thing. And what's cool is they've clearly been thinking about this for some time because the features that back up this latest wave with the release of SWE-1 started with wave 5. This was using awareness of terminal commands, understanding what's in the clipboard, which security-wise, a bit questionable, awareness of the current Cascade version, and awareness of in IDE user searches. So these are all bits of context that you could use in theory to train a really awesome model. And I think the only reason this was able to be done, the training and creation of SWE-1, is because they had such good data. And frankly, a lot of the data that has been used previously to train models has just been used by everyone. So everyone has reached that level of capability. And now the question is, how do you do better? And the way is you build the best tools, make it affordable, and then you try to get it in front of the best engineers in the world. And in terms of what's next, they basically say, look, this is our first shot. It was really good, and we can't wait to make it even better. What I hope to see with this are agents that will be sitting in the background, watching for design decisions, not just watching for syntax problems, things like linting. Things in the back that would say, well, if you maybe built this way, you might be able to deploy it more easily. I think the golden age of this, or the North Star of this, is eventually to have tasks like SRE and QA, QA being quality assurance, so doing code reviews and those kinds of things, and SRE being site reliability, so keeping things running. It would be really cool to have agents do that. And frankly, I would pay a few dollars a day just for that for a number of my personal projects, where it's a lot of work just to remember how I deployed things, what happens, and then if I just have to restart something, it'd be really cool to let an agent do that as opposed to me having to get an email and then log in and do that myself. So really interesting developments. It's also funny, I'm not gonna get into it in this video. OpenAI did just release a new addition to Codex, which is kind of their more pro-focused coding tool. Hopefully this tasking will start to merge with the acquisition of WindSurf by OpenAI. But it was really quirky to see that they're basically still building two different tools in parallel, and whether or not these tools will merge, we'll just have to wait and see. So I'm curious what you guys think. Do you guys vibe code a lot, or do you use WindSurf? Do you use Cursor? What's your favorite model to use with these tools? Let me know in the comments below. As always, I hope you learned something, and I'll see you in the next video.